All right, welcome everybody in attendance this evening for our USA Baseball Homegrown event. We're excited to continue to connect USA Baseball national team alumni to their hometown communities while providing families and youth with the unique opportunity to get to know our national team alumni from their area. Let's take a quick moment and give shout outs to some of the families joining us this evening from Seminole County Public Schools, Orange County Public Schools, Big Brothers, Big Sisters of Central Florida, the City of Seminole Recreation, and all of the other youth baseball and softball organizations that are with us today. Without further ado, we're excited to welcome our guests this evening. That's with an S, right? First time we've had two USA Baseball alums on the same screen for you for one of these. Star USA Baseball national team alums, former big league veterans, and products of Altamont Springs, Florida. Hometown guys, our very own Rickie Weeks Jr. and Jemile Weeks. Rickie on the left. I guess everybody's seeing it the same as I am. Rickie on the left, Jemile on the right. Thanks for joining us, guys. I'm pumped to have both of you. You both sat right there with each other together. This should be fun.
Sounds good. Awesome. Sounds good.
Appreciate the time.
So speaking of Altamont Springs and your childhoods, separately, together, growing up there, we'll go one at a time. What do you remember most or most fondly about growing up there in Altamont Springs? Rickie, let's start with you.
Well, the most fond memories is just baseball, honestly. You know, coming from a family of baseball people, my grandfather played, my dad played. From Altamont Little League to we got Five Points. We got Chet Lemon Juice Baseball at the time. You know, all in all, inside the area, just, you know, it's all been baseball, about baseball. So, and obviously from there, you know, it's a hotbed for football and basketball and things like that. So, we did it all. But, you know, the foundation of our life in Altamont Springs has always been about baseball.
Yeah. Jemile, I mean, mainly baseball for you too?
Yeah, I'll piggyback off from, yeah, definitely baseball. You know, that's something that we were groomed in and that we took a hold into early in life. But also, you know, to add to it, there's a lot of components to our lives, you know, coming up. We did have the kind of the village mentality with our grandparents and being in Daytona Beach, all those other things. But in Altamont, it was baseball, you know, and we also had a heavy faith component. Going to church was a heavy component for us with leadership inside of our family, through our parents to our cousins that were leading congregations in East Altamont, Wynwood Park area. All the way to doing baseball at Eastmont Park and Westmont Park. And just really just kind of an opportunity in that area just to really see multifaceted lifestyles. You have people from all over New York, different countries, you know what I mean? Just kind of the what you would think the model for Florida is was Altamont Springs, the melting pot. So I'll keep it right there.
No, that's good. That's good. All good elements of a good dynamic upbringing, right? Let me ask you guys this, because we have people specifically from the community that are with us. What about favorite local spots when you weren't at a baseball field? What were you doing? Where were you going to eat? Things like that.
Man, I know after the games, some of the like at West Seminole or at Eastmont Park, a lot of times after the games, we would hit the friendlies just past Lake Brantley. You go down 434 in Jamestown it is now. There was a friendlies. All the players went there after the games for ice cream and stuff all the time. Best spot in the world.
And same here, you know, for me, you know, I mean, think about the old Blockbuster down there, you know, 436 and, the place that we grew up in and things like that. So we ride our bike down there, you know, every Friday pretty much and go get some Blockbuster movie with some baseball, the World Series baseball tapes. You know what I'm saying? You have all the highlights of all the World Series and like that. So every Friday night, we go get one from 1960s all the way down to the 1990s. That's what we watch it pretty much every Friday. So those were staples, you know, inside our community right there for sure.
That's great. So we've got – I appreciate you answering my questions there. We've got some visitor submitted questions for some of those in attendance. So let's start with those. And you guys can, again, go one at a time, jump in if one of you's got an answer to it first, however you want to play it. Question number one is from the Steens family, and they say, when/how did you first fall in love with baseball? I mean, I would imagine this is a different answer for each of you.
Right. You know, for me, I mean, you know, I'm the oldest of the family. For me, it was, I'll say about 4 years old. I'll probably say 4 years old. You know, my dad, he never pushed the game in front of me. He never did anything like that. But it was one of those things where he would always, you know, man, it reference baseball. It was always on TV. You know, man, back then it was, man, the WGN for me, but it watched the Cubs or TBS watching the Braves. So it was always baseball on TV. So I just gravitated towards it. You know, my dad's friends would come by to talk about how he used to be a good baseball player, things like that. So, you know, just naturally, you know, just kind of gravitated towards the game. So that's kind of that 4 years old range. That's when I kind of got hooked.
Yeah, I would say for me, I definitely gravitated towards the game early. Obviously, my brother, my dad, my grandfather haven't had played. So I just kind of came through the line. But I was very multifaceted coming up. I love playing basketball outside, playing football, running track outside against my friends in the neighborhood and whatnot. So I would say I always attribute my love for the game and playing baseball according to the time when I started wanting to go to practice for myself. And so for me, that time was somewhere around like 11 or 12 when I really wanted to get it in for myself on the practicing field. But before that, I had always had a passion for baseball. I'd always liked baseball a lot. But I think I really found out what it was about to really hone in on something and enjoy it and want to keep to it around like 11 or 12 years old.
Yeah, I've got a follow up there myself because of the differences in ages and in terms of just the sheer falling in love with the game. Right. I'm interested in this answer for each of you because, you know, everybody has dreams of playing professional baseball at a young age, right? But at some point it becomes like an actionable goal more so right. than it's a dream, right? So like at what ages did each of you, did it sort of register, hey, you know, maybe I could go to college and play and then maybe play professional ball and then maybe make it to the bigs. What did that progression of thought look like for you?
Well, you know, for me, you know, I think for me, it was early on that you know, you have to, you know, write your paper on, you know, what you want to be when you grow up, you know what I'm saying? So in kindergarten, first grade, I'll never forget, man, writing a whole paper on, you know, I want to be a professional baseball player, you know what I'm saying? So that's the natural progression for me. And then going from there, you know, you toe the line a little bit and Altamont Little League baseball, you know, where we played at, and make an all-star team. Then you make the all-star team, okay, you know, I'm not bad. Then from there, you know, you go into high school and, you know, showing some skills there and things like that. So I think that's a natural progression at an early age, what you want to do. But I think, you know, there comes moments where it just naturally, it's like a natural, I guess, habit for you to understand, okay, if I want to do something in this game, I have to put the work in. And then if I put the work in, and let's say in high school, I felt like, okay, I might be able to get a job, you know, and get a job out of this.
Yeah, I would say probably the same thing for me, honestly, around, you know, I wasn't really sure if professional ball was going to come out of the work that we were doing, that I was doing. But I knew I loved the grind. I knew I loved the consistency. I knew I loved competing against the other side and trying to beat the pitcher and make the plays. And for sure. I love the excitement of the game. And so it taught us a lot, too, even on our on the moral character side. You know, you fail so much and it was just teaching so much. And I was lost in that part of the game. So I didn't really know too much thinking about professional ball until the conversation started happening in high school. And it was more so, and I knew I was good before then, because like my brother said, you start getting respect from a lot of different places when you're playing on that level. And that respect came very early for me as well. I remember signing my first autograph at 10 years old or whatever. And somebody's parent was like, no, you're going to be there. You're going to be good. Like, whatever, I said, you know. So she was right. And I was like 16, 17 when it was kind of like, hey, Miami's looking at you, professional team, this and that. I seen my brother get drafted. So it got more real Probably around that 15, 16, 17 year old age frame.
I like that answer for both of you guys, because it tells me, it indicates to me that you were good because you were locked in on the process. It wasn't about, you know, thinking about where you were going to be. The reason for your successes is because you enjoyed the day-to-day, the process, the grind, like you said, Jemile. So that's perfect. Perfect answer. For the second question, this comes from the McLemore family. Did both of you know that you wanted to play professional baseball as kids, and did you play other sports? So you've touched on this a little bit, but you know, did you know you wanted to play pro baseball as kids? Did you play other sports?
Yeah, for sure. You know, like we said it before, I think both of us, you know, at an early age, I don't know about Jemile, but myself, that's what I always wanted to do. As far as other sports, I mean, we played it all. I know for me, baseball, basketball, football, coming up, and you know, I can't really think of anything too much other than than those major sports. And being here in Florida, football is a pretty hot topic here. So playing that right there, Pop Warner, and then they go to high school. You know, I played 1 year in high school, but that was always a staple of my neighborhood, you know, per se.
Yeah, and it's the same thing for me. We both basketball, football guys outside of baseball coming up. I love playing basketball coming up, me personally, and I love playing football too. But baseball always had that staple for us coming all the way up. But, I guess we answered, you know.
Wrestling track too.
My sister, you know, our sister is a Hall of Fame track runner at Southern University. Yeah. So people that are from here probably understand some of that too, if they have any of our history. But basketball and football, did it all the way up, did it in high school as well. And had a few accolades in some of those sports, but baseball definitely took the cake for me.
And to those youngsters that perhaps play multiple sports and want to prioritize baseball or softball or one of the others, what would you say to them about the benefits that you got as baseball players from participating in those other sports?
They all help out each other's sport. The main sport is baseball, but you know, playing basketball is just the IQ, and playing football is IQ is the thinking before the play starts. Plays are drawn up, knowing where to be. I think of that, but also from the physical standpoint, I think the main part was that was explosiveness, quick off the dribble, keeping feet on your shoulders and things like that in football, being explosive, from staying in small spaces and things like that. So for us, that translated to baseball well. And to me, I'm sure I could probably say the same thing for Jemile, but, those sports, I'm gonna never forget. I remember playing Pop Warner 1 year. And I remember I was going to my body and things like that. I'm like 12 years old. And I remember my first baseball game back from, the first time in a while having a ball off of baseball, and I come back and play baseball. The very first hit to me in the infield, I'm diving and I'm jumping and throwing. And I'm going to my dugout. There's about like, man, where'd this come from? I'm like, I don't know, but I think it's from football and basketball or something. I don't know what it's from. But just the whole from sport to sport, I think it helps out one another. I think, more kids should play more sports, and just, helps out each other.
I agree completely. You know, cross sport training is where it's at. You know, the dive and play in the hole is basically a football move. It's like up downs in football. You're diving, you're catching, you're popping up, and you do that 200 times on the football field. It's not that hard to do it on the baseball field afterward. The play up the middle or behind the back play is a basketball move. You do that a couple times in basketball, learning how to pass and get assist. Your peripheral vision and ability to get your body in that position is natural. So those are things that definitely came from cross sports, for sure.
Yeah. The question number three is fun. It comes from the Penaga family, I believe. We are brothers and are 14 months apart in age. We play and train together. Did you do the same? And how competitive were you two with each other growing up?
I'll take that question right now. Okay. So, man, me being the oldest, okay. So, man, we just think what I never wanted to let up anything playing as my brother. It was video games, it was baseball, football in the yard, soccer. Man, we used to play roller hockey, you know, in the street on you know, rollerblades, things like that. I never wanted him to feel like he got it because I'm trying to let up for him. You know what I'm saying? So for me, let's say, for instance, the game that we loved the most was we would take tennis balls, stand probably 30 feet in from each other and fire it as hard as we can and see if you can hit it. You know, let's say out of 30 balls, you might only hit five or 10 balls. You're so close on as hard as you can, but, you know, you get points, you know, for touching the ball or things like that. So striking somebody out. So I'll tell you what, it was some heated moments. I know my brother, you know, he didn't really like that too much, but I think kind of, you know, I mean, I think it helped him out a little bit. You know, I honestly think so. But at the same time, it was very, there was some heated moments there. Some moments when my mom and dad came home from school and had to separate us, you know, a few times, you know, breaking some bases, you know, the whole cliche on breaking bases and pieces on the wall and lamps and things like that. That was definitely us, you know, so playing softball inside the living room and things like that. And, you know, we did it all. And yeah, it was very competitive, very competitive.
Ditto. Ditto. It got real spicy out there. But I was no slouch, though. No, I was bringing the heat. I was bringing the heat out there. So I was going as hard as I could every time. So it definitely helped in my development for sure, all the way through.
Man, I am so I'm a twin. I can relate to that so well because my brother and I both were athletes. We played some of the same sports, but a lot of different sports. So I gravitated toward baseball where he was more of a soccer guy, but you know, I always had somebody to play catch with and throw with. Right. And for his sake, he was a goalkeeper. He always had somebody to kick with. Is that something that maybe later on in life, you guys, it almost doesn't register when you're a kid, I don't think, because like just the idea that, oh, this would be different if I was an only child. So now I am incredibly thankful that all those years I had a permanent partner for things like that. Yeah. Right. I mean, so I would imagine you guys feel the same.
Yeah. That played a big deal in the upbringing right there. It's just having another child with you that happens to be your sibling. And now on the level that he was able to operate on and play on, here I am being challenged on that level. So you're really advancing faster than kids that don't have that same opportunity. And so I think vice versa, even though I was younger, he had the experience to get the extra practice in. Sure. Other guys were not able to get that work in or somebody who I hope, you know, once I started to get to like 10, 11, 12, had the ability to kind of hold my own to where, okay, it's still practice. It's still opportunity to get some work in. So I think looking back on it all, the dynamic was it was a recipe for success, regardless of the fights or the rough times or the arguments or whatever it was. It was a recipe for success, having another sibling that was able to play with you and kind of, you know, not let up, but also be supportive in the fact of challenging each other.
Right. Yep, man. And for sure. Because I think, you know, point out, you know, man, you know, some specific we being yard and he's trying to pitch, you know, he's coming up, he's trying to pitch and like, so I'm the guy, I think we have some old catcher's gear. I'm putting on catcher's gear. I've never caught before in my life. I'm putting on catcher's gear with the old catcher's mitt. I'm getting down. I'm trying to show, hey, out in front, keep your elbow up and things like this. And so beyond what you are, we tell guys this now, like when you're able to teach, you learn for yourself as well. So when I was doing that, and to be honest with you, I learned it myself. So I'm telling him to do this, but sometimes as a baseball player or any kind of athlete, you forget something, you take stuff for granted. So that was it. That was a time for me to teach him or to show him certain things, but also to remind myself of what to do.
Yeah, no, that's a good point too. That's a good point too. These are great, man. We've got, we're down to number four here. This is from the Morrell family. What was your biggest challenge that you had to overcome as a youth player?
As a youth player. I think for me, as a youth player, I think the biggest challenge was, I guess, as the attention started growing and the professional attributes and all these things started coming and coming and coming, I think it was more so about managing relationships, friends, family. I would say even in my early part of my life, we were raised pretty graceful, you know what I mean, to be grateful for everything. So I never really saw too much of a struggle with the accolades and stuff coming in my early years. We took everything in stride and remained faithful in the course that we were raised to be in. So I think more so for me as it got just past college and beyond, and when money started coming and things like that, that's when the challenges started kicking in, trying to understand how to manage life, transitioning from the youth side to adulthood. Mm-hmm. And that's just managing those relationships with family and friends and people that want things or try to get things from you, and understanding how to deal with that in a space that you've never been in before.
Yeah, you know, and a ditto to that as well. For me, I think the most challenging moment of my life was in my high school, trying to get looks and things like that, and playing out a position I thought and things like that. So for me, was the aspect of me being the oldest. Yes, my dad knew baseball, but the process was different for me back then. I think back then, before social media, before the perfect games, before the area codes, just things like that, I was coming through to where, okay, you almost had to get invited to these showcases and things like that. So I wasn't able to get to those things. So I think the process of the whole thing, as far as me being in high school, playing out a position, I thought, and doing some things that I thought I was getting or progressing in, but it wasn't coming fast enough. So then trying to find a college to go to and things like that. So I think those times were kind of hard for me to get through. But man, like my brother said, I think the faith aspect comes into very big for me. As a word of our family, but the trusting in what the process is supposed to be, still believing in what you can do, and still just going through the motions of, okay, I still got to keep my head down, still got to grind. We still got to work hard to get to try to get to go something I'm trying to get to, and that's, playing amazing baseball.
Yeah. And in both of those cases, it led you to us, Team USA members,
for
right?
Sure. Sure.
So we love that. So we love that about your journeys. This next one's from the Morales family. What obstacles did you go through growing up, and how did you motivate yourself to get to where you are today? So a similar question, but maybe something aligned with more specific obstacles rather than the overall challenge.
I would say for me, I can speak on, both sides. On the baseball side, definitely size was a thing that was always out there against me. It was always something that people always talked down about, always felt like I wouldn't be able to suffice within the professional ranks or the next level, whether it was going from 12-year-old field, jumping into the big high school field, like, can the kid get the ball out the infield, or is he going to be able to hold a wood bat for a full season? And all those different things that was complete eyewash, in my opinion. Because if you got that dog in you on the field, you're going to make it happen no matter what. And that's what I was going to do. And still can to this day. But, God and life has taken us a different path so far. But, they know. But at the end of the day, also, at a certain point when my brother was gone and my sister was gone, that had become a little bit of a challenge. I was there with my mother, and she had gotten sick when I was in high school, real sick. Where she had like a deathly ill situation, and she ended up coming out of that over time. But I happened to be the child that was home, that was there during that time, and managed a lot of those things and relationships and things like that on your own at that point. And so that was one time frame where there was some challenges there. Again, the faith component, that's why I teach that even to the kids that I train and whatnot, is the self-talk and faith component. We're not going to struggle the same way as if we don't have a faith component. I struggled in a way that I did have one. So even though we faced some things that a lot of people have faced, they're not glorified, within my speech. We had the tough times. We had the different things going on. We didn't have the $1 million Christmases and all the silver spoons and all those different things and all of that as well. So for us, it was just more so about family. And at that point, my mom was very sick. My brother and sister were in college. And so it was a different dynamic to deal with at that time of life.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, be more specific on my end. I think for me was the summer after my senior in high school, I still didn't have anywhere to go to play college baseball. So going through the whole process there and trying to understand, okay, I have these, man, one or two offers. Okay, what am I going to do? They weren't my top choices coming out of high school, obviously. But beggars can't be choosers, you know what I'm saying? So for me, it was the process of trying to get through that transition of, okay, I know my goal is still to be a Major League Baseball player, but most guys who have those goals, they have goals after high school too as well, and they've already fulfilled those goals as far as either getting drafted or having a place to play in college baseball. So for me, still not having a place to go, I kind of went through a little transition there where it was unknown. I just didn't know, and I didn't know what to do. So just go through the whole process and things like that. That was a struggle, but at the same time, I was able to understand that, keep my head down again, keep working hard and also trying to figure out exactly, okay, what I want to do. And the Southern University was that call from God, and, that helped me out as well.
Mm-hmm. Great stuff, guys. I really do appreciate those answers. This next one comes from the Ridinger family in Lake Mary. What was the best advice you were given as young kids to improve your game? Maybe something from dad in this case?
Probably.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Probably from dad.
I'll say this right here. You know about my dad. He had a real funny, I say it's funny way to, get under my skin or to push me. It wasn't the yelling and screaming. It wasn't, okay, you have to do this, you got to do that. We knew the game. Our baseball, our IQ was very high in the game. But what he would say was, if he didn't feel like we were working hard enough, or if he didn't feel like we were doing something, then you leave a baseball game, you're 0-4. My dad was pretty good about, we get in the car, we're not talking about baseball right away or anything like that. He was real good at that, out of myself. But he would kind of casually throw in there, man, that Johnny, man, he had a good game today. He 3-4 today. And I'm looking at him like, okay, man, where you going with this? Well, I saw him in the cage the past 3 or 4 days, and I saw you outside playing basketball and football. But, if you want to be a baseball player, I like Johnny's game right now. And you went 0-4, he went 3-4. So it was no argument. It was just, guess what? That night I was in the baseball cage hitting my life away. You know what I'm saying? So it was a subtle way to get to me, but it got to me, if that makes sense. So. I appreciated him for that because I know that it kind of stuck me on my skin. It's like, I wanted to yell and scream at him, what I'm saying? But I couldn't do that. That's my dad, what I'm saying? So, but yeah, that's one of the instances I think that kind of, I guess kind of held me accountable.
That's a great story. Yeah, that's great.
I'd say the similar thing, honestly. Working hard is what we knew. That's what we were raised on. That's what we were groomed on. That's what we watched. That's what we seen. We just put work in. Not a lot of people had the work ethic that we had. And I mean, I would be at the cages sometimes 1 o'clock in the morning, and that was leisure time. You know what I mean? Had practice earlier that day, whatever it was. And it got to the point to where some of the teammates would come and they'd want to catch on to your time. That you go hit and stuff like that because you just keep leading the way on work ethic. And I think if you talk to our dad today, or our mother, but if you talk to our dad today concerning baseball, work ethic is going to be one of the main things that comes out of his mouth. And then consistency. If you remember, we used to always have to hit 10 to 15 balls straight to the middle of the cage, or we couldn't hit freely. So it was like every time we went to the cage, we had to do 10 to 15 balls straight to the middle of the net. Every day, forever. So the work ethic was a little bit different than the common core that we were around all the time.
No, that's good stuff. Very good stuff. From the DeSantis family, how do you get out of a slump and stay positive?
Fake it. Key word, fake it. And you know what? I say that lightly, but I really do mean that. A lot of times, I don't care who you are, you could be Mike Trout of baseball, he's going to go through slumps. But I think the common denominator there is to understand that, okay, anytime you step on the field, anytime you step in that batter's box, anytime you're you know, come up the pitcher's mound, you have to, you know, exude confidence. And sometimes you have it, sometimes you don't. But guess what? You won't know it. My brother won't know it. I'm going to be that guy in the batter's box that is going to be my day today. And you have to believe it and visualize it and just do it. You know, so, you know, that's my goal, my answer right there.
Yeah, I would say same thing. Honestly, you got to come in with that confidence every day. And if you've been putting the work in preseason, which obviously spring training for us and prior to that, your confidence to stay and get out of your slump, you can't lose that. You got to know the work you put in will pay off. So if you're not putting the work in, then the slump is likely to beat you up throughout the season. Now, if you're putting the work in, you know you're coming out. So it's more of, again, I go back to the faith component again, it's more of a belief factor that this is not something that's going to last the whole time. This is just something I have to exude confidence and I have to continue to put the work in that I know produces success for me. And it always comes back and produces success when you keep that mindset. But you can't panic. That's the number one thing. Once you panic, everything goes haywire. You have to know that you put in the right work. And once you know that, you're going to come out of that. So you don't really have a slump that doesn't go away.
And don't work just to work. You work with a purpose. Always work with a purpose, because we all can get in the cage. We all can go in the field and just work and work, work to, you know, ourselves to death. But if you're working on something, man, work with intent, and I think good things will go from there.
I'm going to pause to point out that there's a trend. There's a theme developing here, because they're different answers, the past two things that you guys have said. But it all comes back to hard work and consistency. So Jemile, just like you said, if the consistency is there, then, you know, it's a math game. You know, at some point the numbers are going to be in your favor and things are going to start clicking again, right? So it's all about putting it in the work, like you both referenced just now, and the consistency that you can, if you become a consistent player, then you don't have anything to worry about during a slump because it's going to even out theoretically.
Absolutely. Yeah. It can get scary. It's scary, though.
How about this one from the Jacksons? How do you stay motivated when things are difficult? Same sort of thing, right? Fake it? I'm looking at you, Rickie.
Hey, I'm going to spit out all my water right there. But, yes, fake it. Yeah, no. it's, you know, sometimes you fake stuff and things like that, but, you know, I think the biggest thing is understanding yourself. A lot of time, I think a lot of time players, they go through certain situations, you know, you're high energy, you're mellow, you know, everybody has different personalities. And I think for us, we got to understand ourselves and look ourselves in the mirror and to understand what we can do to get better. And, you know, that comes from talking to people, I mean, talking to guys who've been there before, but, you know, trying to be as open as you can with yourself and with others to understand yourself. You know,
I go with the same thing. Honestly, yeah. Getting through difficult situations, the same thing. And again, self-talk, I keep saying it, you know, if you have an inner fortitude, self-talk and the outside world, the outside presence, if you can block that internally and keep yourself positive inside, then you can start exuding the proper things that from the inside, and it'll start changing your situation slowly but surely. You got to be stronger within than you see outside, for sure. So,
you guys have been awesome. We normally keep this within about 35 minutes, but I didn't factor in that I was going to get two answers for each question. So I've been treating it like it's a one on one.
My kids are asleep, so it should be fine.
So I've just got a couple more here. This one I like because you're sort of pulling back outside of yourselves. We talked a lot of nitty gritty ball these past few questions. This one's a little more general and sentimental. What does the game of baseball mean to you both? That's from the Pichardo family.
The game of baseball for me, it means life to me. It became that just in the fact that it kind of held a lot of the essence of our being, you know what I mean? It brought my work ethic out. It brought my confidence out. It taught me discipline. It taught me how to deal with failure. It taught me the ups and downs that I had to deal with outside of the game. I knew how to deal with them. So it taught me life skills. The game of baseball taught me how to build relationships with teammates, different people, white, black, Asian, Hispanic, all across the world, having friends from Europe to Dominican to Cuba to Japan to all over the country. Not many games are going to teach you to the finite level where 70% of the time you fail, right? And you got to be very, very excited about that 30% because that makes you the best in the game. So this is a game of life. And I attribute this game to a lot of things, a lot of successes, and a lot of things that we do going forward. I think it's the most powerful game you can play.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, well said right there. You know, the baseball is about a game of life. Man, a lot of time you go through life, you know, man, trying to deal with certain situations, man, whether it's good or bad. Going to baseball, you know, you fail more than you succeed. So trying to understand, okay, myself again, and how do I deal with failure? Okay, baseball is going to bring that out of you. You know, how you deal with success, and keep it to a point where you're not, I guess, self-righteous or, you know, cocky or arrogant or anything like that, because this game will find a way to bring you back down. You know, understanding the full spectrum of life through baseball, the baseball definitely does bring it all out of you. And, you know, that's what we're just proud of, and be from baseball.
Yeah. No, I think it's really well said for both of you. And obviously, you know, it's a family affair for you guys. You've carried it after your professional careers and are passing down what you've learned within the game. I mean, it's a large part of the makeup of each of your lives. So I think those were both really well said answers. This is sort of a combo question. We got sort of the same question from the Morris, Alexander, and Roussel families. What advice would you give to an aspiring young athlete, or what advice would you tell your younger selves if you could go back now?
Well, I'd say a younger athlete, get in the game, learn the game from a good coach, and have fun. Go into the game, learn the game from a good coach, and have fun. That's it. Jump out there and have fun. And the game, literally, the things that we're telling you that we have experienced in this game, it's going to teach you these things. If you just stick with this game, you're going to learn all of these different things. It's going to provide you all the tools to access all these different attributes in your life, because that's just the game of baseball. That hitting component and that pitching to find that zone component is so strategic and so hard to do that it's going to pull something out of that child that they would have never expected. So again, just having fun with the game. And for my younger self, it would be the same answer. It would be the same answer. I played the game hard. I'm not even going to lie to you. I played the game hard. I played the game with fun. I played the game with grace. We did everything to the best of our abilities. So I have not one regret on how I took sports and baseball itself at all in my childhood. We played the game hard, and I enjoyed every single part of my childhood playing baseball.
Yeah, I mean, Jemile said it right. It's you know, it's the love of all things, and you know, in this case, baseball. So for me, it's just respecting the game, having fun, man, number one, and the rest going to take care of itself. We talk about all the time with our youth and our some players alike. You know, we can do all the training that we can do in the cages and things like that. But if you're doing that and that's being carried over to, you know, to the field without having a true love for the game or having fun in the game, I mean, you won't succeed at all. So the biggest thing for us is to understand, yes, the game can be a business sometime and when you get to a certain age, but the fundamental concept of succeeding in baseball is just having fun. You know, because man, like I said, again, you grew up playing this game, you grew up practicing, you kind of grew up being coached, playing for certain teams, things like that. All that's out the window once you start making, you know, money and things like that. So the only thing you can fall back on is having fun in this game.
Last thing for you guys, you're wearing the Caps. So of course I got to ask, and I happen to know you're doing some incredible things with your foundation, the Weeks Brothers Foundation. What's the latest with what you guys are trying to accomplish with the foundation, and how did it all get started?
Well, man, it really started out really with some camps here in Orlando, Florida. We started at our old high school, Lake Bramley High School, here in Altamont Springs. And for us to understand, okay, we do want to do something, you know, get back to our community. I know I was probably halfway through my career, things like that. And it was always something that we wanted to do. We just didn't know how to do it. So we just started with camps and things like that. So we got picked up, I think, 5 to 6 years on down the road by Major Baseball, come out. They paid for everything for us, for our camps. And we saw what the effect was on the kids that were able to come there for free. So we definitely wanted to you know, get that same, I guess that same feel for our future camps. So that's where we come up with the Weeks Brothers Foundation. We wanted to provide kids inside the area. Now over the past 3 years, 200 kids per camp of free baseball. So if they're able to come out there, man, rub shoulder with some of our friends and things like that in these baseball camps. And also get taught by the best too as well. You know, I mean, kids gonna take that stuff and just and run with it. You know, I mean, to be honest with you, I mean, wish we had that when we were kids as well. So if you had that, you know, I don't know, maybe it might speed up the process a little bit for them. You know what I'm saying? So for us, it's just the act of trying to get it back and you know, doing some other stuff as well that we're trying to go forward with. You know, we're trying to empower. You know, some other community aspects as well. I know my brother can kind of speak on that as well.
Yeah, because we and then alongside with the camps, also the college component happened. We've had college scouts and college coaches and different scouts come out of the prior camps. I know certain rules have kind of slowed that opportunity down in the last couple of years, but a lot of our guys have had and young kids have had an opportunity to get college looks and go to college from our camp. So we've been very blessed by that. And then the other things that we have going on as well is empowering the organization, We Family United, which is now going into a Pine Hills Sports Empowerment. And that program is baseball and softball with nonviolence life skills training connected to it. Everybody knows from the Orlando area, also the Altamont area, Pine Hills being one of the focus areas where, you know, there needs to be a focus to helping out the youth and bringing more fun, fair, clean play. That was an area that we prospected and saw that, you know, we could definitely step a footprint here in this city, understanding the dynamic of our city and knowing that that was there. And we had the chance to put a 35-year professional nonviolence coach a part of what we're doing. We've got about 50 kids in the program right now, and we'll be pushing the program very soon here on an even deeper level. But it's definitely been something that me and my brother are happy about. Powering along with the county, Orange County has helped us out, power this program. And so going forward, I think that we really want to impact this youth space as strong as possible and kind of bring a light to the youth that are maybe less fortunate or more in need.
That's, man, I can't say enough how fantastic that type of work is. So you guys truly are community guys, you're community oriented. Something like this is perfect. So it's been a thrill. This has been a lot of fun, and I'm sure enlightening for those in attendance. So thanks, guys, Rickie and Jemile, and all in attendance this evening. We hope it's provided your families with a chance to get to know the Weeks brothers from your community. And to all youth in attendance, we hope it goes to show that you too can accomplish anything that you set your mind to. To those families interested in additional baseball, softball related tools and tips, and for more info on how to register for your child for a local league, we encourage you to visit playball.org as well as usabdevelops.com. Again, it's playball.org as well as usabdevelops.com. So thanks, everybody, for joining us. Rickie, Jemile, thanks again a ton. This has been great. I mean, two USA Baseball alumni on the screen at the same time sharing some wisdom.
That's right. Yes.
It's been fun, guys. I appreciate it.
I appreciate it very much. Thank you.
Have a good one. Thank you.